I don't know when we're live.
We're live now again.
We're live? We're live again.
We are live.
We're live. Okay. Thank you. Thank you for waiting. And we've found us another speaker who's willing to talk to us. He will have a session later today. But first, let me introduce you. What your name is?
Maurice de Beijer, and I'm from the Netherlands. And I'm here to talk about React and the future of React, more specifically.
So that talk is updated weekly because the future is changing rapidly, right?
Not weekly, but yes. I've actually had this talk for more than a year with the same title,
yeah.
But it's kind of the content keeps switching. I keep dropping some older stuff and adding newer stuff to it, so it's kind of a moving target.
So for people who saw your title and thought, well, I see that, seen that presentation, they will still be encouraged to come today, like because you have new content.
The first part is probably the same as you saw before,
yeah.
But then at least half of it is going to be new content, probably two-thirds.
Two-thirds. And what time is your session today?
It's after lunch, so that's quarter to two or something like that.
I hope they don't have an after lunch dip then, because then they will be... Or will you keep them awake?
I will energize them.
You will energize them, that's great.
And if I need to, I'll get some Red Bull. And
get some Red Bull.
I think I can energize them by myself.
Maurice, yeah. Just a question. I like your shirt.
Yeah.
Just tell us about what's happening.
October. Well, that's actually an interesting project. I believe it's from DigitalOcean. They kind of encourage people to do open source work, and I kind of completely agree with it, so I'm not associated with it. But they basically have Hacktober. If you open 4 pull requests in the month of October, then you can qualify one of those t-shirts. So if you just Google Hacktober, you find the website, register first, and then open full pull requests. They don't even have to be merged, which is kind of weird. Just open them, and it could be anything. Fix a bug, fix some documentation, add some like that.
And this is on GitHub. Do you know the URL of the hot?
No, if you just Google Hacktober, you'll find it. It's okay. A DigitalOcean thing, and they've got like, I believe, 50,000 shirts to handle.
Oh,
So
do a pull request, get a t-shirt, and get involved in open source, folks.
Right on.
Okay, so right. That's a good message. Yeah. But shall we go back to his session? React it's about, right?
Cool. Yeah, React.
React.
Which is also open source.
Which is also open source. Man,
what is
you're into open source.
Everyone should be.
Okay, great. Can you give a little hint what you're going to tell the people today in your session?
The first thing I'm going to start with is React Hooks, which is already available since, I think, January. Mm-hmm. And that makes writing React components a lot simpler. Like, you don't have to create classes anymore, get confused with how the this keyword works in JavaScript.
Yeah.
You kind of create really simple functional components and then use hooks to add state management, side effects, and those kind of things to it.
Nice.
That's already available. Then I'm going to show lazy loading of components. So you don't have to create one monolithic application. Mm-hmm. You can create a small loader application and then load parts of your application as the user first needs them.
Okay, great.
So that's lazy loading, which builds on top of Suspense, which is also available already.
Nice.
Then I'm going to show how to use Suspense with asynchronous data fetching. Because right now you typically do an AJAX request and you kind of have to maintain that state. Am I loading data? Is it already loaded? Were there errors? The kind of boilerplate code you write quite often. Well, with asynchronous data loading in Suspense, you kind of get the situation where you render a component, you ask for some data, but if it's not there, React is going to suspend your component from rendering.
Okay.
No code you have to write. So you just ask for some resource, and if the resource isn't there yet, that component will suspend, and as soon as that resource is there, React will actually render that component and display it on screen.
Nice.
So, no more tracking, is it loaded, did stuff go wrong, etc. Well, you'll probably have to cater for that somehow.
So that's a little bit easier now.
Yeah, it removes all...
Is that in production also?
Not
yet.
The suspense part is, because that's the same as with lazy loading of components, but the lazy loading of data resources isn't yet.
Yet, okay.
What version of React are you working?
We don't know yet.
Okay.
React 16.10 just shipped last week. It's not included there, so I'm hoping for 16.11, which will be published presumably early, maybe end of this year, early next year.
So if I have an app that's still using that the old code to manage my own little life cycle, I can move to the new framework and then...
No problem. That will still just work.
Okay.
But then when the new asynchronous loading ships, you can start changing it over if you want to. Like if your app works fine and you don't want to make any changes there.
If you have unit tests.
Of course you want to have unit tests there.
On a different point quickly, I'm not a React guy. I haven't really worked on React that much. How is your personal opinion on Blazor? And how do you see it as a rival?
It is a rival because it's developing web pages, web components, that kind of stuff. But not a very big rival because Blazor is very much .NET centric. It very much appeals to .NET developers, C# developers. And React is used by developers who've got no .NET background whatsoever. So those are very unlikely to switch to Blazor. Blazor also has a very nice server-side technology, which will make developing applications very easy, but mainly for .NET developers, I think.
So there could still be a kind of combination between Blazor and
oh yeah, it's
React,
like
right?
If you build an application, you choose the technology which makes sense for that application and for your knowledge, your skill set. It's not like we all have to use the same thing. Just like React and Angular and Vue and Svelte, they all coexist, and different people will use different frameworks, libraries in different situations. That's the same with Blazor. It's another choice.
Yeah.
It's a perfectly good choice. They're going to coexist perfectly nice.
We just had a discussion on enhancing one's toolbox.
Yeah.
And this is just another tool like this.
Yeah, nice.
And it's a kind of tool that won't appeal to the typical front-end developer who's not done any .NET work. He's not going to learn .NET, C#, just so he can get into Blazor. At least I don't think many will.
And most probably if you do a back-end, you will do it in Node.
I typically use .NET on the backend, but that's because of my skill set. I use Node, but typically for smaller things. Not because there is anything wrong with Node, it's just existing toolset, existing clients.
Yeah.
Either work.
Nice. Cool. So, well, I will wish you the best of luck with your session later on today.
Thank you very much.
And if you'd like to, you can always come back to tell us how your room was. Was it filled with people? And
of course it was. I don't know actually yet, but...
No, of course.
Let's assume it is.
We assume it is. But one thing, what is the one thing you want to give away to the people who will join your session later today? What is the one big giveaway you want them to know when they leave the room?
That there's a lot of other awesome technologies out there. React is one of them, but there's other stuff out there. Learn more stuff, expand your mind.
Great.
That I couldn't see it better myself.
That's definitely, I couldn't see it better, what you just said. That's nice. Thank you very much for your time. Thank
You're
you
welcome.
For being on the SDN Cast Live today.
Thanks for hosting this. Awesome job.
Thanks.
Okay.